Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents An Alternative History of Britain, The Hundred Years' War, by Timothy Venning, narrated by Liam Gerrard. Introduction. The so-called Hundred Years' War is one of the dimly remembered stock clichés of 900 years of fraught Anglo-French relations. In the popular memory, there is a long tradition of mutual antagonism between the nations on either side of the Channel, from the Battle of Hastings in 1066 to Anglo-French disagreement over European centralism. In the case of conflicts, the British usually win, as shown by Crecy, Agincourt, Trafalgar and Waterloo, with London place names such as Nelson's Column a constant reminder. In this tabloid-fueled myth, it seems appropriate that the two kingdoms fought for over 100 years, from 1337 to 1453, though in fact this is a myth, and there were long truces, in particular in Richard II's and Henry IV's reigns. Even under militant Edward III, there were truces in 1350 to 55 and 1360 to 69, and the wars, rather than war, were most active in short bursts in the mid to late 1340s and 1350s, the 1370s, and finally in the struggle launched by Henry V from 1415. One of the underlying reasons for conflict was the English king's possession of lands in France, the remains in the Duchy of Aquitaine of the so-called Angevin Empire of Henry II and Richard I, which was mostly overrun in 1203 to 04. Under the Treaty of 1259, this remained part of France, so the English king, as its lord, was his neighbour's vassal, like the other holders of French feudal fiefs, as those English kings who had been dukes of Normandy in 1066 to 1204 were the French king's vassals too. This produced inevitable grounds for tension. How could one king be the loyal vassal of his potential enemy, and continual grounds for problems, with legal excuses for confiscation in case of a conflict? If Philip Augustus of France had reconquered Aquitaine, as well as Normandy or Anjou, or the 1259 treaty between Louis IX and Henry III had made the latter fully sovereign in Aquitaine, would there have been less warfare? In the complex mid-medieval world of a pan-European, French-speaking culture, of which the English kings and nobility were part, the post-1066 English kings were, in fact, dukes of Normandy, who had gained England by conquest. Their politico-cultural orientation was French. The vagaries of the Norman dynasty's succession had seen England and Normandy pass to the son of Henry I's daughter, Matilda's by Count Geoffrey of Anjou, Henry II, Count of Anjou, and buried in Anjou, ad Fontevraud, not in England, and overlord of Brittany. Henry added his wife Eleanor's Aquitaine to this huge melange of polities, and was more powerful in France than its king, his overlord. The so-called Plantagenet dynasty, the name was a personal sobriquet of Count Geoffrey, only revived as a surname by the House of York in the mid-15th century, was as much French as English, and until the mid-14th century rarely spoke English. Abandoning its European role after losing Normandy, Anjou in 1204, to concentrate on conquering the British Isles was never a likely option, with a succession of foreign wives an additional incentive. The marriage of Edward II to Isabella of France in 1308 and their son Edward III's resultant claim to the French throne after her three brothers died without surviving sons, 1316 to 28, was the seeming reason for the post-1337 English wars in France. But the situation was more complicated than the matter of honour and justice to pursue his legal claim that Edward's propagandists portrayed. For a start, the Salic law ban on a female inheriting or transmitting a claim to France was not actually stated in 1328 and only appears later in the century, though its being part of the reason for the French court's choice of heir in 1328 is logical. Edward did not pursue his claim until usurper Philip VI had assisted his enemies in Scotland and seemed to be threatening to encircle him, and both Philip's aid to Scotland and confiscation of Aquitaine followed normal precedent for times of Anglo-French tension, for example 1294. Edward was perfectly willing to give up his claim if the price was right, once his demands for a restoration of his ancestors' lands in France had been granted, 1360, but, like French legal threats to their English royal vassals in 1154 to 1337, it remained a latent political weapon, ready for reuse. If Charles V of France had not been able or willing to obstruct the English king's demand, as Dauphin, in 1358 to 60, or showed bad faith in implementing them after 1367, would a war have resumed? What if the distinctly war-averse Richard II, who reached a comprehensive Anglo-French settlement in 1396, despite nobles' objections, had not lost the throne to his aggressive and insecure cousins of the House of Lancaster in 1399, or England had been weakened by his replacement, Henry IV's overthrow in 1400, 1403, or 1405. There would have been no Henry V invading France to restart an attempt to build an English empire in 1415 in these cases. Arguably, Henry would have done better to concentrate his limited resources on reoccupying and fortifying a defensible redoubt in Normandy than claiming the French crown and overstretching his army. But would taking the French crown have ever been practical military politics for this ruthless opportunist, but for the unpremeditated murder of Duke John of Burgundy by the French royalists at Montereau in 1419? This drove his son Philip to throw the huge weight of Burgundian resources onto Henry's side, and when he changed sides again in 1435, the English suffered disaster. If Henry had not died aged 35, could he have conquered France in the 1420s, or at least forced the war into a lengthy stalemate? Was Joan of Arc's appearance in 1429 epoch-making, or the sort of reverse that the overstretched English would have received anyway? And once French fortunes revived, could the English have extricated themselves by abandoning all except a defensible Normandy? Was the humiliating cost of accepting military reality unacceptable to English policymakers, bogged down but too proud to give up? Was the unworldly pacifist, an exaggeration, Henry VI, more realistic than his aggressive uncles? Or was he undermined by his fiscal incompetence and poor choice of generals? And did Charles VII of France double-cross Henry in the mid-1440s truce by his hard-line doggedness in trying to retake all the English conquests? Chapter 1. Edward III and Edward IV, the Black Prince. Luck or shrewd judgment? Edward III, the Black Prince, and the comparative English triumphs of 1338 to 60. What was inevitable, and what was down to chance? The claim to France, could it have been made in 1328, not 1338? And was the outbreak of conflict Edward's fault or Philip's? Despite the English victory at Crecy in August 1346 and conquest of Calais in 1347, the practical achievements of the English expeditionary forces by 1355 were limited. Edward III had secured a stunning and unexpected victory against a confident and numerically superior force from the largest state in Western Europe in 1346, showing that a new military power had arrived on the scene. The dominance of French knightly chivalry on the battlefield, and of the comparatively centralised French state in providing finance, men and supplies for war, had been givens of the early 14th century international power system, particularly since the reign of the ruthless Philip IV, 1285 to 1314. France, the largest and most efficient state in Western Europe, and ruled by a line of competent adult male rulers, except in 1316, had even secured a compliant papacy based near its territory at Avignon, with a succession of French or French-allied popes from 1309. King John I had acceded at birth in 1316 and died within days. England seemed to be a marginal minor power, with the defeat of the unimpressive, luckless Edward II by the Scots in 1314 and his overthrow by his French wife, Isabella, in 1326-27, adding to its poor reputation. Despite Edward III's impressive military debut in the 1330s against Scotland, his claim to the throne of France was not expected to succeed against the incumbent Philip VI, 1328-50, not least was the reason that France was over twice the size of England, and as of 1328, the English kings only held the central core of Aquitaine, the province of Guienne surrounding Bordeaux, as a French royal vassal, plus minor and indefensible Ponthieu in Artois. The population of the French king's dominions was around 20 million, and of Edward III's around 5 million. And if fully used, the French king's potential army could be up to 60,000 men strong. The general call-up in France, the arrière-ban, was, however, not applicable to all provinces, and some important ones were exempt. In practice, its alternative of paying a fine, rather than fighting, was often resorted to, and the money used to hire mercenaries. Nor were the French nobility or populace likely to look with favour on a foreign contender for their throne, as we can already discern a degree of basic national rivalry between the English and the French in this period, even though the English elite was French in its culture, as it had been since 1066. Edward III spoke French as his primary language, as had his royal ancestors, although he seems to have been able to speak English too. French was the international language of high culture and chivalry. The first primarily English-speaking king of England was either Edward or his grandson, Richard II, ironically born in France. The choice of Count Philip of Valois, the late King Charles IV's cousin and nearest male heir, as the new King of France after Charles died on the 1st of February 1328, was not universally accepted. The decision had to wait until it was clear that Charles' pregnant widow would not give birth to a son. There were nearer heirs in the female line, from Charles' sister and his brother Louis X's daughter, and it was arguable if the legal, customary ban on female inheritance, the so-called Salic Law, applied to transmitting a claim via a woman to a male. If it did not, either Charles' sister Isabella's son, Edward III of England, or his late brother Louis X's daughter, Jeanne, Queen of Navarre's heirs, were eligible. Edward was closest to Charles IV by blood, but Jeanne's family, from 1332, her son Charles the Bad, were genealogically senior. Jeanne's line had been passed over when Louis X and his infant son John I died in 1316. Edward duly made a claim on France, though not at the time of the succession dispute in 1328, as then he was only 15, and the insecure regency government of his mother and her paramour Roger Mortimer had other priorities. In that context, the Hundred Years' War could have broken out in 1328, not 1338, if it had not been for the English rebellion in 1326, when Edward and his mother, Isabella, invaded to depose his father, Edward II. Due to this, England was not in a state to pursue the claim to France in 1328. The dynamic and warlike Isabella, the so-called she-wolf of France, has received a very bad press from her own time to the present, partly through conventional observers' indignation that a queen could flout normal mores by flagrantly invading England with her lover to depose her husband and led troops in person, and partly from the belief that she was behind her husband's subsequent murder. One theory, championed recently by Ian Mortimer, claims that Edward II was not murdered, but was allowed to flee to the continent in disguise. Whether she was a murderess or not, the point is that Isabella was quite capable of organising and even leading an army to secure her son's claim to France in 1328, if she had not been otherwise preoccupied, heading a shaky regency with her unpopular and ruthless paramour, Roger Mortimer. If her marriage had not broken down due to her husband's involvement with the Despenser family, and possibly his homosexuality, England might have attacked France in the late 1320s, provided that the exhausting and humiliating loss of the Scottish War of Independence was successfully negotiated first. The power-crazed and acquisitive Despensers were unlikely to have encouraged a war had they still been in power in the late 1320s, as Edward II's chief advisers, given that if either Isabella or a royal kinsman, Earl Henry of Lancaster, Earl Edmund of Kent, led an English army to success, they could then turn it on the Despenser regime. Similarly, Edward II was not enthusiastic about waging war in person, and had had a humiliating experience at Bannockburn in 1314, although he was prepared to fight hard, in extremis, for his own preservation, as he did in confronting Earl Thomas of Lancaster in 1322. But an English government that had avoided the polarisation of high politics in 1322-26 might have risked a French venture, at least if there was a threat to their possession of Guienne, which was possible from an overconfident new French king hostile to Isabella, such as Philip VI. The centralising French crown had tried to confiscate Guienne before, 1294, and the fact that, as of 1259, the English king was the former's vassal was a problem easy to exploit. Edward III's formal claim in 1338 only occurred once Philip VI had repeatedly shown his ill will towards his rival, who he seems to have consistently undervalued. The young and highly energetic English king was the type of ruler to seek to revive his grandfather Edward I's successes against France as a morale booster for the monarchy's reputation after the loss of Scotland. But as of 1333-38, he was already engaged in war in the latter country, so he was not free to look for a target. The death of the ailing Robert Bruce in 1329 left his 5-year-old son David II as king, and left the Scots without an adult ruler, and so Edward sought to restore the enforced vassalage of Scotland, which he had had to abandon in the Anglo-Scottish Treaty of 1328 by installing a vassal king to replace David. The physical reconquest of Scotland as an integral part of England was impossible, so that part of Edward I's international strategy had to be abandoned. Instead, Edward III reverted to his grandfather's strategic plan of 1292-96 by restoring the Balliol dynasty, under Edward Balliol, as his vassals. The king did not, however, act rashly. A private expedition by a party of pro-Balliol barons, expelled from Scotland by the Bruces, the Disinherited, to restore Edward Balliol and regain their just rights in 1332-33, saw surprising success, with a victory over the Bruce's army at Duplin Moor and the capture of Perth. This initial success showed that the Scots army was less dangerous than it had been under Robert Bruce. His nephew, the Earl of Moray, and his lieutenant, Sir James Douglas, had both died recently, and so Edward could intervene himself safely in 1333 to aid the Disinherited against a Bruce fightback. This led to a major victory at Halidon Hill near Berwick, the conquest of most of the lowlands, and the flight of David II to France. But the Balliol regime soon met serious resistance, and throughout the mid-1330s, Edward III was undertaking regular expeditions to Scotland to back them up. It was then that Philip VI of France not only gave David sanctuary, but sent troops to aid him, 1335, and allowed damaging raids by French warships on southern English ports, principally Portsmouth, the usual embarkation point for English expeditions to France. Even if assisting David II was in the French strategic tradition of trying to weaken England by propping up its northern enemy, the so-called Old Alliance, Philip had less excuse for claiming that Edward's ceremony of homage to him for Guienne in 1331 had been defective and was thus legally invalid. The implication of that was that he could confiscate the duchy whenever he wished. Philip also required Edward to surrender the refugee French dissident noble Robert Artois, and specifically declared in 1336 that any peace was impossible so long as he was in England, the sort of minor issue that could be overlooked with goodwill. Thus, although David II's refusal to abdicate his claim to Scotland for Edward Bruce's lifetime, then succeed him, stymied the 1335-36 papal attempts to solve the Scots crisis, Philip, not Edward, was the main obstacle to a settlement. The papacy, keen for Edward and Philip to use their armies for a crusade in Asia Minor, instead to back up the 1334 naval attack on Smyrna, was endeavouring to sort out the Anglo-French tension throughout this period, and had he been willing, Philip, a man with pretensions as an international crusading leader and with dynastic interests in the Byzantine Empire, could have diverted his energies to the crusade as a devoted son of the Church. There was no foolhardy and unrealistic attempt by a young and inexperienced English king to conquer a kingdom with vastly superior resources. Rather, Edward was driven to respond to repeated French provocations in 1331-37. This culminated with Philip's announcement of the confiscation of Guienne and the title of Duke of Aquitaine in May 1337. Did the insecure new ruler, Philip, feel he ought to emulate his renowned great-uncle Philip IV's confiscation of 1294 and miscalculate the reaction? Notably, Edward and his senior noble commanders gained useful military experience in Scotland, giving him confidence to tackle Philip, and he pursued similar tactics there to his later ones in France, leaving time-consuming sieges alone for ratsier marches. Personalising the issue of Anglo-French conflict, contemporary literature claimed that Count Robert of Artois, who had opposed Philip's claim in 1328, provoked Edward to swear to invade France and seize his rights at a banquet, the Vow of the Heron, by taunting him over his cowardice. This is far too simplistic, though it probably suited Edward for it to be thought that he was a chivalrous hero king, like King Arthur, who undertook solemn vows at ceremonial occasions and was too honourable to back down. The formal English claim was much a diplomatic weapon as an idealistic, non-negotiable decision to claim Edward's legal inheritance. By making himself the rightful King of France, he enabled potential French or French-allied defectors, such as the leadership of Flanders and Brabant, to save face by transferring their allegiance from one usurper King of France to his rival, rather than breaching their oaths of loyalty. At the time of his claim, he was doing his best, in person, to rally the rulers of the Low Countries and northern Germany to his cause, aided by the fact that his wife, Philippa, was sister of local Count William of Hainault, who inopportunately died. Given the size and resources of France compared with England, Edward, like all predecessors waging war on France from the time of Richard I, needed a coalition of European allies to even the odds, provide men and money, and attack France on a second front. This was bound to rely on Flanders, an autonomous county restive under French control since the crushing of past revolts, and the Holy Roman Emperor of the German kingdoms and principalities. Given the pro-French stance of Count Louis of Flanders, to be killed at Crecy in 1346, any English attempt to secure money and troops from the region was likely to be resisted by him and to draw in King Philip too. In financial terms, important Flemish towns such as Ghent, Antwerp and Bruges were vital sources of loans for the impecunious Edward, who visited them in person with his entourage. In military terms, the Flemish ports were also a potential source of invasion threat to England, a major factor as late as 1940. Hence, Edward's initial concentration on securing reliable allies in Flanders and his expedition there in 1339-40, leading to his first crushing victory over the French, at sea, the Battle of Sloss. In Germany, Edward made a prestigious and munificent pilgrimage to the Shrine of the Three Kings, the Magi, at Cologne, and secured a grant of the title of Vicar of the Holy Roman Empire from the Emperor, Louis of Bavaria. This obliged Louis' vassals to support him in war as their sovereign's trusted lieutenant. The most that can be said about Edward's aggression in claiming France in 1337-38 is that he jumped the gun by naming himself King of France in documents while papal mediators were still trying to arrange peace. But chances of the latter were minimal, given Philip's equally provocative confiscation of Aquitaine. Under the show of being an honourable paragon of chivalry, keen on his just rights, Edward was to be prepared to abandon his claim if the alternative offers were substantial enough. Indeed, when he first made the claim verbally in 1337, he postponed making a public statement of it by issuing letters patent, or a heraldic coat of arms containing the title, allegedly to satisfy appeals by the alarmed Pope. The formal claim, in writing, and a heraldic device, was only made in 1340, from Flanders on French territory, and thus probably at the request of the local lords to secure their support for him as their rightful king. It was to be retracted in 1360, and modern historians are more convinced than earlier interpreters that for all Edward's bold claims about it being a matter of honour to pursue it to victory, he was quite prepared to reconsider it as practical politics and was less naive than appears. By making such a show of his devotion to the claim, he put up the price for surrendering. Arguably, practical politics rather than points of law or honour were also involved in the French court's rejection of Edward's claims. The Salic law ban was not cited by them in 1328, and they could hardly deny powerful local candidate Philip's claims on behalf of a foreigner. Did Edward in reality understand this, but use it as a weapon after Philip aided Scotland? The First War, from 1338 to 1350. Conquering France, or even recovering the English king's ancestral domains of Normandy, Maine, Anjou and Aquitaine, would not be easy, or a short process, not least due to the number of walled towns to take and the limited effectiveness of primitive artillery. Maine and Anjou, moreover, were the personal fiefs of the House of Valois, which now held the French throne, so giving them up would seem a mark of ignominy for Philip VI. There was also the minor but psychologically important problem of which kingdom was to be named first in documents. As king of both England and France, Edward would insult his English countrymen if he named France first, but it was the larger and more prestigious of the two kingdoms. In the end, he named England first on documents intended for an English administrative use and audience, and France first on those to be sent to the continent. He could not dodge the issue this way in his official heraldic arms, and thus put the French royal arms in the more important upper left-hand quarter of the device. The size of France and easy defensibility of walled towns presented a more serious problem. Current bombards, primitive cannons, could fire stones at city walls at a slow rate and produce breaches for attackers to use, but were not yet decisive and were cumbersome to cart around. Their first decisive role in a siege was over a century ahead, arguably at Constantinople in 1453. The English king could not afford to take a great number of them with his army anyway, and most sieges had to rely on starving out the defenders or disaffection within the walls. Concentrated work on undermining the walls by sappers and mounting a quick attack was, however, possible, but only on special occasions when a major force was present and speed was the priority. It was also difficult if a town was surrounded by marshes. Mining was impossible, and siege towers would sink in the mud, as at Calais in 1346-47. The English tactic of avoiding slow, piecemeal sieges, but staging impressive marches across large areas of country, had already been seen in Scotland, where Edward had marched right up the northeast coast in 1336, rather than concentrating on securing all the castles to his rear first. As later in France, this and calculated devastation was intended to terrify local nobles into submission, but at most secured ephemeral success in terms of areas controlled. Arguably, Edward was more of a gambler than Edward I in avoiding long sieges, although he kept his nerve during setbacks. The financial crash of the Florentine banking houses of Bardi and Peruzzi, who were funding his war with huge loans, in 1343, failed to curtail his expensive invasion plans, though it now appears that he did not owe nearly as much as the Italian chronicler Villani alleged, 13,000, not 225,000, nor bring the banks down by refusing to pay his debts. There is also the question of the 1341-45 Civil War over the Breton succession to consider. This led to a proxy war between France and England on behalf of their rival claimants, the late Duke John's niece, Jeanne, and her husband Charles of Blois, Philip's nephew, and his half-brother John of Montfort. Ironically, in declaring a female able to inherit Brittany, the Paris Parlement contradicted the Salic law ban that Philip used to justify his inheritance of France, though technically Breton, not French law, was cited. Jean and Charles' loyalty to Philip was what counted in Paris, and Montfort was believed to be about to transfer his fealty to Edward. Granting him Brittany could lead to him opening its ports to an English invasion fleet en route to Guienne or Normandy. Philip tried to arrest him, so he fled and called on Edward to back his claim. The English duly invaded Brittany. This gave Edward and his captains, for example the Earl of Salisbury and Sir Walter Manny, invaluable experience of fighting the French on French soil, perhaps making victory in Normandy in 1346 easier. Without this war, would the current Anglo-French truce of Esplanchin have held for longer? but Philip was unlikely to have allowed the potential defector Montfort to take over Brittany. If Duke John had not died in 1341, however, this would have postponed the clash and denied Edward a rehearsal for his Norman War. It has been argued that Edward initiated a military revolution in England, both in his systematic and well-organized provision of a suitably sized, trained and equipped army, from captains commissioned to raise a fixed contingent, and in his adaptation of the tactic of archery to inflict devastating showers of arrows on his opponents in a concentrated barrage. This, as seen at Halidon Hill against the Scots in 1333, would destroy a packed mass of infantry or cavalry, provided that they did not have the chance to overrun the archers first. The new English tactics relied on a barrage of missiles to destroy a numerically superior force, not mere weight of numbers on foot or horseback, a contest that the English were unlikely to win against any major French army. The army that he led to Normandy in 1346 was substantially smaller than the overall French army, and met its king's active troops in the field outnumbered by around 3-1. The English army had around 13,000 to 14,000 men, with the French over 30,000, relying heavily on 6,000 to 7,000 Genoese mercenaries. The southern army of the French king, under his son Duke John of Normandy, later King John II, was luckily absent, attacking Aiguillon in Aquitaine, and did not arrive in time. It was intended to hurry north and trap Edward south of the Seine, but he slipped across the river at Poissy and headed north to Ponthieu, chased by Philip's army. Philip again lost the chance of trapping Edward as the English forded the Somme unexpectedly, but eventually caught him up at Crecy. Edward was able to inflict a devastating defeat on the French at Crecy with disproportionate losses. The French casualties included 11 princes, led by the King of Bohemia, Duke of Lorraine, and Counts of Alençon and Flanders, one archbishop, 8 senior lords, and 80 bannerets, plus 1,542 knights and esquires in the area by the English front line alone. The French secret weapon, the Genoese crossbowmen, could not fire as fast as the English longbowmen, and were massacred in a hail of arrows, which cut through their protective clothing. Unable to attack from several sides at once due to the terrain, the French had to resort to a frontal charge and push and shove tactics, and were just held to a standstill and slowly driven back. The English army was clearly more professional and better led, as well as a more coherent and experienced body. The French relied on a mixture of contingents from their allies, larger in number, but unused to fighting together, and reliant on one basic tactic of charging the opposition and riding it down, or hacking their way through. The French tactic might have worked at Crecy had the disciplined English not stood firm, and the nature of the site prevented the larger French army from attacking from several sides at once. The Prince of Wales, in his first battle, was hard-pressed and was knocked off his feet in the melee, a sign of how dangerous the French push forward was. Hence the famous exchange when his father, Edward III, was asked if he should send in the reserves to rescue his son, and he replied, "Let the boy win his spurs." In the event, the French were halted and ground down by superior fighting power, and the brave but futile charge and death of the blind King John of Bohemia, Philip VI's close ally, seemed to sum up the French attitude to war. With the French army forced to pull back in disarray, the English were able to go on and besiege Calais unhindered, starving it out and commencing a 210-year occupation. Notably, Edward chose not to head for Paris despite the road lying open. The impressive walled city of around 100,000 inhabitants was very likely to surrender, and it was too far up the River Seine for an easy siege due to the long supply route to the river mouth. Philip failed to use his army to relieve Calais during the winter of 1346-47, though he did arrive in the vicinity and rescue or a battle was expected in the town, possibly due to fear of another battle like at Crecy. French naval relief efforts were defeated, and the garrison eventually had to surrender. The well-publicised and exaggerated for show fury of the king at the stubborn defence hints that he realised he could have had to give up the blockade. The outbreak of the Black Death, destroying the manpower of both sides and making the war a lower priority, then aided the successful arguments for a truce, although proxy fighting over the Duchy of Brittany continued. The rout of the French's Castilian allies at sea off Winchelsea in August 1350, though less decisive than as played out by English propaganda, helped to prevent the Castilians from using their potent fleet to disrupt English links to Guienne, or even a Castilian invasion of that province. The Castilian naval carracks were larger than English ships, and thus could either ram them successfully in close combat or fire missiles down onto the decks. Their intervention was to be feared and was a disaster for England after 1370. Indeed, in the battle off Winchelsea, Edward's own flagship was rammed and nearly sank, which it would have done had its damaged side not been jammed against that of its attacker. Edward and his men had to leap aboard the Castilian ship and take it for their own safety. The king came close to drowning and was, as usual, lucky in battle. But the possibility of a Franco-Castilian alliance in 1350 was a result of two unexpected setbacks for Edward and could not have been anticipated. First, his daughter Joan, en route to marry King Alfonso XI of Castile and secure an alliance, died of the Black Death, and then Alfonso died of it too, at the Siege of Gibraltar. Had events gone according to plan, England and Castile would have been allies through the 1350s, and possibly Alfonso, born in 1310, would have been securely still on the throne in 1366-67, when in real life England had to intervene in Castile and so waste time and resources there. In the long run, did the crucial deaths of Joan and Alfonso undermine the English war effort 16 years later? The War in France, Stage 2, from 1355. How the war was nearly avoided. The so-called Hundred Years' War fully resumed in 1355 at the end of the agreed truce, but this was far from inevitable. Indeed, the peace negotiations of 1354-55 seemed likely to be successful. The terms agreed by Edward's and John II's secret negotiators at Guienne early in 1354 anticipated the settlement of 1360, in that Edward was to receive an enlarged Aquitaine, including the Limousin and Poitou and parts of the Lower Loire Basin, but not Normandy. Also, Edward made no quibble at this point over renouncing his claim on the French throne. The sudden French willingness for a deal was probably due to the domestic security problem raised by Charles of Navarre, who, with his equally unsavoury brother Philip, had murdered the Constable of France in a private dispute early in 1354, and then sought English aid for his subsequent rebellion. Edward sent Duke Henry of Lancaster to arrange an alliance, with Charles' need for his aid meaning that he could insist that the latter should accept his rival, Edward, as King of France. They would divide up the country between them. Had this worked, Edward would have had a substantial native French faction backing him out of mutual hatred of the usurper, Valois, King of France, anticipating the English-Burgundian alliance of 1420-35. He might even have gained Paris, though Duke Charles was less likely than the early 15th-century Dukes of Burgundy to accept a block of English territory in France, including Normandy, where he had lands himself. Unfortunately, Charles received a better offer, with full pardon from King John, and blandly switched back to his side, humiliating middleman Lancaster. But the threat of revolt from Charles continued to worry King John, and the result was the Anglo-French secret talks and tentative agreement at Guienne. The papacy, hoping to end the war and enroll the two kings for a crusade against the Ottoman Turks, who entered Europe at Gallipoli in 1354, organised follow-up talks at Avignon at Christmas 1354, but it became clear that the French were not serious, and John had had second thoughts. Lancaster's embassy left Avignon, and the preparations for war resumed, but it is clear that it was John who had regained confidence in his military power, not Edward, who was at fault. As in 1335, Edward was not the principal culprit in the collapse of peace talks. The resumed war in 1355 seemed to be headed for the long haul for the English, with the assumption that Edward's proposals at Guienne represented his basic aims with Normandy less vital than Aquitaine. Whether Edward seriously hoped to secure recognition of his rights to the Kingdom of France, or just to use this as a bargaining chip to gain a vastly larger share of Aquitaine and or Normandy by treaty, his practical gains so far were small, Military victories were impressive psychologically and gained him a reputation and possibly more international allies, but they did not substitute for territory. If the main French army evaded battle and relied on their walled towns to hold him up, his expeditions were reduced to impressive and unchallenged marches across wide areas of country, which he could burn, loot, and demoralise, but not achieve anything tangible, as seen by Edward's expedition to Paris in 1359-60, and his son's razzias across central France in 1355 and 1356, the Prince of Wales, and 1373, John of Gaunt. They were backed up by increasing numbers of chevauchées, led by lesser captains, starting with the Duke of Lancaster, and then turning to practically independent free companies led by men such as Sir Robert Knollys. These involved deliberate application of terror and destruction, or seizure of valuable French resources by burning, pillaging, and assorted atrocities, and soon spiralled into burgeoning free enterprise brigandage out of control of the King of England. These campaigns served to demoralise the French government by destroying its property and food supplies, thus reducing the amount of men and supplies available to the French armies and the amount of money that the king could raise in taxes to pay his troops. They showed that the king could not defend his people, a substantial point in an era of chivalric values, but the attackers often achieved little either and lost men to disease, exhaustion, and ambushes en route. This post-1355 tactic of hit-and-run raiding and psychological demoralisation by terror was in contrast to the systematic conquest of Normandy, town by town, which Henry V was to launch in 1417, when he, like Edward III, had defeated the French army in the field, Crecy, Agincourt, and taken a major port to use as a base for invasion, Calais, Harfleur. Edward chose not to return to Normandy and overrun its remaining towns, a time-consuming and costly business, but to keep his armies mobile and secure conquests by forced concession from the French government, probably arising from another major military victory. But in any case, he had very limited support from local French nobles, for example Sir Godfrey de Harcourt, so mass desertions were unlikely, though to encourage this factor, he deliberately refrained from plundering the land around towns that he hoped would surrender of their own free will, such as Reims, in 1359. A war of sieges was a slow business, and Edward's main gain of 1346 in Normandy, Caen, was due to luck, as his men were able to follow retreating troops from the garrison into the town and prevent them from shutting the gates. It is also probable that the showy and restless Edward, who had a taste for display and great set pieces, such as his numerous chivalric feasts and the pardoning of the six burghers of Calais, did not have the patience for many long sieges that Henry V did. His alleged impulsiveness may have been exaggerated, but he was significantly willing to risk his life in unnecessary personal combat, as when, in 1350, he joined his knights to intercept a party of French warriors sneaking into Calais for a hand-to-hand encounter. This piece of vainglorious risk, like the king indulging in personal combat on a Castilian ship off Winchelsea as his flagship was rammed, was in the tradition of kingly knight-errantry, by Edward's ideal, King Arthur as interpreted by 12th and 13th century writers. It helped to bond him with his nobles and win the admiration of his men. Like Caesar and Alexander, he fought in the front rank, but there was always a personal risk in such actions. Like Henry V, he was quite capable of using terror and atrocities as a political weapon and clearly understood psychological warfare. The whole tactic of chevauchée was based on this. But although his blackmail of the French elite into surrendering by destroying their financial military resources and humiliating their sovereign was not enough to gain him the throne in 1359-60, it succeeded in securing a generous offer of all Aquitaine and Poitou without him having to spend time, money, and troops in garrisons in Normandy, as Henry did after 1417. To that extent, it worked, and unlike Henry, he made a point of being seen to be merciful, with his carefully staged rage at the burghers of Calais being ameliorated by an appeal from his wife. A proper king was supposed to be wrathful to his enemies, but also open to generosity, and to know when to be chivalrous to his opponents. In this respect, Edward understood man management far better than his father, Edward II, and grandson Richard II, who both resorted to executions and secret murders of opponents and lost their thrones as their elites turned on them. As of April 1356, it was John II who seemed to be a rash and untrustworthy ruler, alienating his elite with his sudden personal arrest of Charles of Navarre and some of the latter's aides at Rouen Castle, and execution of the latter without trial for the murder of the Constable of France. There was an obscure plot involving Navarre to put John's son, Dauphin Charles, on the throne at Christmas 1355, a first for the dynasty, which argues for considerable noble discontent. If it had succeeded, would the English have faced a French army in 1356, backed by Navarre, but boycotted by John's loyalists? The new war saw the Prince of Wales dispatched to Aquitaine in 1355 and his deliberately provocative razzia into central western France in summer 1356, which was to lead to King John II leading a major army to intercept him. In the event, the clash was a second overwhelming victory for the English. The overwhelming French numbers served to disadvantage them, and John and many of his nobles were captured. The Battle of Poitiers on the 19th of September 1356 served to secure the Black Prince's heroic reputation, show that the English now seemed to be invincible, and shatter the morale of the humiliated French elite. King John, never an impressive leader or a shrewd statesman, was removed from the French command as he was deported to captivity in England. The regency government of his eldest son, Charles, was put under severe pressure, to which social unrest added, and virtual anarchy in Paris and across France followed in 1357-58. The disorganised peasant Jacquerie, with its overtones of class war against oppressive landlords, was supplemented by the seizure of Paris by a faction of reformist citizens led by Étienne Marcel, reducing the Dauphin to a cipher until he could regain control. The breakdown in French government and military paralysis seemed to justify the English tactics and present the current French government as disastrous, and in 1359-60, Edward could march across France to the gates of Reims and Paris. When the cities failed to fall, he opened the negotiations that were to secure him most of Aquitaine at the Treaty of Brittany. This advantageous English position would have been impossible but for the crushing triumph at Poitiers, which started the unravelling of the French government. But it should be remembered that this narrative can be put forward as a result of the English winning at Poitiers, and that was by no means a foregone conclusion. As of the 18th of September 1356, the Black Prince's expedition, moving back from its point of furthest penetration into French territory towards Angoulême and then Bordeaux, had been unexpectedly intercepted by a larger French army, which their scouts had not expected to find. Indeed, he had been intending his march northeast from Guienne to Anjou, another ancestral English dominion, in early September, to lead to a rendezvous with the other English expedition under his cousin Duke Henry of Lancaster, operating southwards from Normandy. Instead, the waiting French forces at Tours avoided battle, which could have led to defeat and the fall of that city with its crucial Loire Bridge, and stayed inside the city until King John approached with a large army down the Loire from Orléans to rescue them. The Black Prince had to move back south to avoid being trapped, abandoning the main purpose of his campaign, and even then John's army managed to intercept him, hardly a triumphant campaign that had gone according to plan. Instead of having Lancaster's army to support him as planned, he was seriously outnumbered when John cut across his line of retreat. The startled prince was willing to open talks for a truce, as suggested by the would-be mediating Cardinal of Perigord, although this enabled more French troops to arrive overnight on the 18th to 19th to reinforce their king. When he moved off on the 19th, it appears that he was not determined on battle and merely had this as an option if the circumstances proved hopeful. If possible, the English would evade the French or only clash briefly in passing, and would march on towards safety. In the event, the confident French precipitated a battle. Moreover, the initial French plan, showing full awareness of the English use of archers to destroy their ranks, was to use their limited cavalry force to ride down the archers and so destroy the English secret weapon. Instead, the two French cavalry commanders, the Count of Clermont and Marshal d'Andreham, ignored orders and succumbed to temptation to ride at the English vanguard and rearguard respectively, as they found the English army on the march. The English vanguard, under the Earl of Warwick, was unable to use its archers to shoot down the French horses, as the latter were well protected from in front. But another contingent of archers across the river were able to shoot the horses from behind. In the case of the Earl of Salisbury's rearguard, the French, under Clermont, bunched up to ride through a gap in a hedge, and a body of English archers within range used this chance to pick them off. Clermont was killed. The French cavalry were thus nullified, and the first wave of French dismounted knights, who were supposed to charge the main body of the English once the archers had been dealt with, moved forward to the attack without waiting to find out what had happened. This grouping, led by the king's heir, the Dauphin Charles, was probably about the same size as the waiting English, and was certainly not large enough to overwhelm them. Joined by Warwick's men and protected by a network of barricades, the English held the attackers back, and once the latter retreated exhausted, the Dauphin was escorted out of the danger zone to keep him safe, which would have looked like retreat to watching French troops. The second wave, led by the Duke of Orléans, failed to move forward as planned when it could have posed a serious threat to the exhausted English, who instead had time to rest and collect spent arrows for reuse. The prince sent one of his best commanders, the Captal de Buch, and a small cavalry force to sweep round the French army and to appear to its rear, thus causing fear of encirclement, though at first some of the English thought he was abandoning the battle, which could have caused them to flee instead. Then the prince ordered a general advance towards the French royal banner, the Oriflamme, to the blast of trumpets. These unexpected moves left the French on the defensive. Still outnumbering the English but not acting coherently or showing any initiative, they appear to have been driven downhill off their current position by Noailles Wood towards the river and systematically broken up. The English military elite concentrated on smashing in the French king's bodyguard, and the latter's struggle ended with King John and his son Philip held prisoner. According to the English, 2,446 French men-at-arms were killed, around 80 senior nobles were killed, including the Constable and Marshal of France, the two senior military figures, and Geoffrey de Charnay, noted earlier, owner of the Shroud of Turin. Some 1,974 captives were taken, including one king, three royal dukes, 13 counts, 5 viscounts, and 21 bannerets. The victory was total, but, as noted earlier, it owed a great deal to French miscalculation and poor command, and until the actual battle, it had been the English who had had the worst results from the 1356 campaign. On those occasions when the French royal army prudently avoided battle, as John did when Edward III marched into Artois from Calais in autumn 1355, the English could burn and loot, but achieved nothing practical. As a result of the greatly improved English position after Poitiers, the subsequent peace talks of spring-summer 1357 included an offer by the papal mediators for full restoration of all Edward III's ancestors' lands, that is, Normandy, Anjou, Maine, and all Aquitaine. Perhaps surprisingly, he still insisted that the formal negotiations should discuss his claim to the French throne, instead of taking his chance to secure vast territories with many walled towns and cities that he could hardly take by storm. He may have reckoned that the shaky government of the Dauphins in Paris were not yet sincere and were stalling for time, but accepting the proposal would put the onus on them and earn them papal disapproval if they failed to deliver. As it was, the interim terms agreed in May 1358, leaving the issue of the French crown for later, required the French to pay a ransom of 4 million florins for King John, with 600,000 florins to be paid before his release, plus restoration of all Aquitaine and Ponthieu. The Dauphin's government then failed to hand over the first instalment on time and rejected King John's desperate agreement in the Second Treaty of London to hand over Normandy and the overlordship of Brittany as well, which would have given the English control of all the French coast from Calais to Bayonne and ended French naval raids on the English coast. Possibly John realised that his ruined country might well not be able to pay the ransom money, and he hoped to fend Edward off with enough lands to persuade him to overlook this, in which case John was too confident of the Dauphin's acquiescence. The surrender of Normandy was not that disastrous for France at the time, given that it was a stronghold of their king's rival Charles of Navarre, as Count of Evreux, and was riven by civil war between the two factions. But the Dauphin and his estates general were clearly confident of holding on to it somehow. Given the recent turmoil in Paris itself in 1358, and the possibility of more, their ability to hold their nerve in spring 1359 and not agree to any terms King John suggested was surprising. This precipitated renewed war, and may indicate that Edward was correct to distrust that the French regency in Paris would obey their king's wishes and capitulate. Thus his refusal to surrender his claims yet was logical. But when he marched on Reims in 1359 to force the issue of his claim by securing the site of French royal coronations and having himself crowned, he was unable to take the city, which held out against his blockade. He had to move on to ravage the Ile-de-France and Burgundy to obtain supplies, attack Paris to try to secure the capital, and or force the Dauphin out of the city to fight. Neither occurred, and was eventually forced to reopen negotiations. In the resultant Treaty of Brittany, he had to waive his demand for the French crown, which he could have done at far less cost in 1358, in return for all Aquitaine and Ponthieu. He also failed to secure Normandy or Anjou, Maine either, and reduced King John's ransom from 4 to 3 million florins. The settlement was thus poorer than he would have achieved in 1358-9, had the Dauphin and Estates General backed up their king's proposals. Edward's failure to secure either the French crown by a coup de main with Reims, or force the French capital to surrender in winter 1359, spring 1360, was partly due to factors beyond his control. At the Siege of Paris, a freak hailstorm ravaged his camp, a circumstance that he could not have anticipated. But it must be asked if he seriously thought that his army could secure victory in this campaign, at least by inducing mass desertion by the leading citizens of Reims and Paris to save themselves from starvation, or, less likely, the sack of their cities. Or did he expect his physical presence in the region at the head of an army to lead to mass defections by the war-weary French nobility? The indications are that he was overconfident, especially that Jean de Cron, Archbishop of Reims and a distant relative, would lead his city to abandon the French royal cause during the blockade of Reims. Possibly he was unable to accept that nationalist resentment of himself as an Englishman would be a potent factor in keeping up resistance, or that the lengthening list of English atrocities would stiffen resistance, not induce sensible surrender. The successful defensive stance of the city authorities at both Reims and Paris was critical to Edward's failure, and for this the Dauphin must take principal credit. His determination to resist the English was vital, both in 1358-60, and again when he resumed the war in 1369-70. Had the Dauphin been captured at Poitiers with his father and brothers in September 1356, France would have been left leaderless, and the administration would have been likely to fall to a military coup by the royal family's would-be supplanter, Charles the Bad, King of Navarre. This direct descendant of Philip IV in the female line had been barred from the throne by current French legal interpretation of the Salic Law in 1328, as Edward had been, but was eager to seize it, and in 1356-60 did his best to use his lands in Normandy as a base for overthrowing the Dauphinist regime. Had the Dauphin been captured at Poitiers, would he have seized Paris? Or could he have secured Paris by his shaky alliance with the Marcel faction's regime in 1358, and used his leadership of a large faction of the northern French nobility against the insurgent Jacquerie to achieve military victory against the Dauphin? The latter, fleeing the Paris insurgents to Meaux, was able to rebuild his forces and later regain the capital. But what if Charles or the Marcel faction had managed to capture him instead? Charles' weak claim to the throne would have meant that, even if he was in control of Paris and claiming to be King of France, he would have had to negotiate a more one-sided treaty with Edward, probably giving him all of Normandy, Maine and Anjou, or possibly only the latter two, if he, a local landholder, was strong enough to hold on to Normandy himself, but he was unlikely to have been willing to give up his own claim to France on Edward's behalf in 1359-60, unless indignant loyalists of the captive French king and royal dukes seized Paris from him, and he needed Edward's support to regain the capital. The years after 1360, an unexpected successor to England, the effects of the decline and early death of the Black Prince long-term on Richard II. The psychological investigation of figures from past centuries is a problematic venture, not least due to the nature of the evidence. Richard's deposition in 1399 left him, like Edward II, with no sympathetic contemporary chroniclers. But there was probably some connection between his over-dependence on figures, such as de Vere in the mid-1380s, and the early death of his father, Prince Edward, known to John Leland in the 1530s, but not in his lifetime, as the Black Prince, at the age of 46 in 1376. The latter, the greatest military figure of his era, in sharp contrast to his son, whose promotion of peace with France must have led to infuriated veteran aristocrats making unfavourable comparisons, was set to succeed his father, Edward III, and was indeed often referred to in contemporary chronicles as Edward IV. Indeed, Richard of Bordeaux was not even the younger Edward's first son at his birth in January 1367. His older brother died in 1371. But Edward, Prince of Wales and Duke of Aquitaine, suffered a sharp decline in health from the time of his expedition to Castile to restore the evicted King Peter the Cruel in 1367. Seriously ill for the first time in years of hard campaigning during his Spanish expedition, probably as part of an epidemic of dysentery and malaria, his condition returned, and his rule in Aquitaine became less active in the next 2 to 3 years. The contemporary accounts of the bloody flux probably indicate chronic dysentery, though it is possible that there was an underlying medical weakness that this exacerbated, as his nephew Henry IV also suffered serious medical deterioration in his early 40s. Logically, he may have picked up some infection on his expedition to Castile in 1367, as his health had given no concern previous to this time. Whatever the cause, Prince Edward was mostly sedentary in Bordeaux, rather than touring the rebellious frontier lordships to overawe the turbulent barons. This may have emboldened them to risk seeking the arbitration of the traditional overlord of Aquitaine, the King of France, now Charles V, in disputes with the prince, in defiance of the terms of the Treaty of Brittany, which had granted Aquitaine in full sovereignty to Edward III. The alleged arrogance and harshness of the prince as Lord of Aquitaine may also have been exacerbated by his poor health, and so hastened the appeals of disaffected nobles to Charles, though these claims may only be French propaganda. The resistance of a vigorous English royal viceroy in Bordeaux was a novelty for Aquitaine, which had largely been neglected by the crown since the loss of Normandy in 1204. The equally vigorous Simon de Montfort had met similar resistance as governor in the 1250s. Aquitaine, a large and decentralised dukedom with many powerful local lordships, had always been turbulent with the great vassals furthest from Bordeaux, particularly restive. The Lusignan dynasty had defied Richard I as duke in the 1170s. The French kings from Louis VII, reigned 1137 to 80 onwards, meddled in it to encourage revolt, as the ultimate legal overlord of Aquitaine and the hereditary enemies of the English kings. Whether or not encouraged by Edward's ill health, Charles V chose to make an issue of English breaches on the terms of Brittany, for example, not removing all the mercenary free companies from France, instead of just continuing with a technical refusal to recognise Aquitaine's independence, as Edward III had refused to end his claim to the French throne. The French backed the rebels and received their homage in defiance of the prince's rights. The prince was summoned to his overlord Charles V's court and refused, and war resumed. In 1370, the prince, in sharp contrast to his earlier vigour, had to travel to the siege of rebel-seized Limoges in a litter, though the subsequent sack and massacre might have been carried out at any point in his career as a warning to other rebels. The brutality was no worse than that used by the English army as it crossed France on its chevauchée in the 1350s and 1370s. intimidation as a substitute for permanent occupation. The following New Year he returned to England as an invalid, never campaigning again, and was too weak even to travel immediately from Plymouth up to London after the voyage. He played no role in politics, as his father too became an invalid in the early 1370s, the political lead passing to his next surviving brother, John of Gaunt, and lived in retirement in the home counties. By the time of the vital Parliament meeting early in 1376, he was too ill to do more than attend the opening season, and he died shortly afterwards. His father outlived him by a year, and Richard succeeded to the throne at the age of 10. If the Black Prince had been able to operate in politics and war from circa 1370, would it have made a difference to perceived English decline? Henry III had lived to 65, Edward I to 68, and Edward III to 64, and in normal circumstances, Prince Edward, born in 1330, could have been expected to live into the 1380s and probably the 1390s. Among his brothers, John lived to 59 and Edmund to 61, a reasonably long reign by Edward IV from June 1377 would have had major effects on the later reign of his younger son, who would not have succeeded with a quarrelsome and ineffective Regency Council in 1377, and the sense of drift in English domestic and foreign policy in the 1370s would have been less had the ageing Edward III had an active heir on hand. The Prince of Wales, like John of Gaunt, who was the effective head of the government in the king's last years, would have faced difficulties in running policy in circa 1372-77, with the war going badly, and France and Castile now allied to threaten seaborne links to Bordeaux. The prince, like John, would have had to rely on good relations with the reputedly venal royal mistress, Alice Perrers, and tolerance of her grasping court allies, such as Lord Latimer, to secure access to the king, a major source of complaint against John's governance. Tolerating Alice's clique would probably have been more difficult for him, as punctiliously honourable, than for the more pragmatic John, who had his own mistress, Catherine Swinford, and a growing brood of illegitimate children, the Beauforts. John was also accused of excessive and provocative public spending, particularly on his palatial residence at the Savoy, which was to be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.